Hello, and welcome to today's lecture on helical antennas. In fact, we have been talking about helical antennas for the last couple of lectures, and we actually looked into that there are three different modes of helical antenna: axial mode, normal mode, and conical mode. And as I mentioned, conical mode is very rarely used, so we are not going to discuss about that. And we had started our discussion about axial mode, and we had looked into how to design axial mode helical antenna. So let's continue from there. So we had actually seen the example, which is the directivity is given as 24 dB and the numeric value is 251.19. And I just want to mention here that this material has been taken from the cross book. The only difference here is in the cross book they have said this to be gain, whereas I have written this more to be directivity. And as I mentioned in the previous lecture, the gain of the axial mode helical antenna is efficiency multiplied by directivity, and efficiency is approximately equal to 0.6. So that means gain of this antenna will be 251 multiplied by 0.6, which is approximately 150. And we had seen that for axial mode helical antenna, C lambda should be taken between 0.8 to 1.2. So it had been taken as 1.05. I normally take this as 1, and alpha was taken as 12.7, which is between 12 to 14 degree. I generally take this to be 13 degree for my design, but this example has been given in the cross book, so I am continuing with that. And once we have assumed these two parameter, we can calculate the value of S lambda by using this expression, which is nothing but we can say tan alpha will be nothing but S divided by C. That is what is coming over here. So we can calculate the value of S lambda here. So now we know the expression for the directivity is given by this particular expression here. So directivity is known. C lambda has been assumed. S lambda has been calculated. So we can find the value of N by substituting all these values. And that comes out to be 80. Now this is a very large number, so that means the entire helical antenna length will be very, very large. So instead of using N equal to 80, the other option is that we can use an array of helical antenna. Here is an example of 2x2 array, which are actually put something like this here. These are total 4 number of elements. So what we can actually think about it, instead of using one single 80 turn helical antenna, 4 20 turn helical antennas can be used. So now we know that directivity is directly proportional to N. So that means if the number of turns are reduced, so directivity will also reduce by the same factor. It will come to 62.8 here. So now when we want to put these helical antennas, it is very important where we keep it. Shall we keep them somewhere here between the two, spacing to be very small or very large? So it is not arbitrary. One has to do some calculation here, and for that we can actually use the concept. We have been discussing that directivity is given by 4 pi into A divided by lambda square. So from that we can find out what is the effective aperture. So effective aperture is given by this particular expression. And if we now substitute the value of D0, which is 62.8 divided by 4 pi, this is approximately 5 lambda square. So now assuming that effective aperture is a square aperture, even though I don't 100% agree with this particular assumption, so generally I feel instead of using a square aperture, one should use a circular aperture, because let's say if this is a helical antenna, we should really see the aperture more in the circular symmetry. But anyway, circular can be approximated as square, and square also makes it easier to place these helical antenna. So there is not too much of an error here. This is a fairly decent approximation also. So if we use as a square aperture, then side length will be square root of this, which comes out to be 2.236 lambda. So then each helix should be placed at the center of its aperture. So now you need to think about, so if this is a square aperture here, then this will be another square aperture, and this will be the another square aperture and another one. And we are putting the helix at the center of 2.236. So if this is in the center of this, this is also at the center of 2.36 lambda square. That means center to center distance will be also equal to 2.236 lambda. So in this case, dx is equal to dy is equal to 2.236. Let's see this thing in little more detail. So this is the helical antenna side view. So if you look from here, this is a n equal to 80 turn. So one can see that it will be a very long helical antenna. And this will be the front view where we are basically seeing that the helix is there, and this is the, you can say, the center, and that is the ground plane size. Then comes the next part here. So this is again a ground plane, and now we actually have a 2x2 array. You can't see the other one because this will be behind this here. So side view will only show two of these. So 2 n equal to 20, which is there, and then 2x2 array. So this is the 4 helix front view. So you can see one here, one on the other side, and these are the 4. And for n equal to 20, we just notice that the spacing between the 2 helix should be 2.236 lambda. This concept has been extended further. So here we have 9 helix, and each helix has 9 turns. So if you actually see, 9 into 9 is 81, which is approximately equal to 80 turns required to obtain the desired directivity. So over here now, since the number of turns have been reduced, so what will happen? Directivity of each helix will reduce. And if the directivity of each helix reduces, then corresponding aperture area will also reduce. And that means center to center spacing will also reduce. So in this case, center to center spacing should be about 1.49 lambda. This is another example where 4x4 array has been used. Total 16 helical antennas have been used. And in this case, now each helix has 5 turns. So 5 multiplied by 16 will be equal to 80. So now for n equal to 5 turn, aperture area will reduce further, because for n equal to 5, directivity will reduce, correspondingly aperture area will reduce, and hence spacing between the elements will reduce. So you can see that the spacing between the helical antenna is reducing. Now comes the next part, and that is what will be the mutual coupling between these two helixes, because we know that when the two antennas are placed close to each other, there will be some mutual coupling. So here is the plot for the mutual impedance between arrays of helical antenna. So just to show here, so this is plot here is shown in the form of impedance. Curves are given for resistive part as well as reactive part. And this axis here shows separation between the helical antenna normalized with respect to lambda. So one can actually see that the curves are given, let's say, for 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, and up to 1. And in the previous cases we had seen, so for example, let's just go back. We saw that here the spacing is 1.18, here the spacing was 1.49, and for another case spacing was 2.236. So this spacing is much larger than a lambda, and one can actually see that if the separation between the two is approximately between 0.9 to 1, we can see that the resistive part of the mutual impedance is almost close to 0, and also the reactive part also is close to 0. And anyway, even this finite value, which is let's say about less than 5 ohm, that is not going to make much difference when the circumferential or the peripheral impedance is of the order of 150 ohm. So this effect can be neglected. And that is the beauty of the helical antenna, that you can place these helical antennas and they give us a very good circularly polarized antenna performance, and you can use the arrays of these things. In fact, sometimes I also mention these things like a real estate. Suppose we want to accommodate more number of people, then what are the options? So one option is, let's say we make a 80-story building, okay? So instead of making a 80-story building, if you need to accommodate same number of the people, what we can do, we can make 20 story building, 4 of them, okay? And then the another option can be is that we can make 16 buildings of 5 floor each, okay? So that we can accommodate same number of people. So the same way you can actually apply the same concept here, that you want to get desired directivity. So either we can go vertically up or we can have smaller buildings or smaller size helical antenna. So depending upon the space available to us, we can arrange these helical antenna for the desired gain. However, there is another very interesting application which was reported long time back, where what they had done, they had used these helical antenna as a feed for a large reflector antenna. So suppose that this is a large reflector antenna. So at the focal point, we put these helix, and these are circularly polarized helical antenna. So assuming that the signal is coming from the large distance, so it will come in parallel, so they will reflect from the reflector and they will focus at the helical antenna. Or alternatively, we can pump in power through the helical antenna, it will go there and then it will radiate parallel if it is a parabolic dish antenna. Now one of the another advantage is that suppose if this helical antenna is, let's say, right hand circularly polarized, then the wave which goes reflects back from the reflector, that will be left hand circularly polarized. So if we transmit right hand, it will reflect back left hand. And since between right hand and left hand, generally since the axial ratio is fairly good, the reflected polarization will be at least 20 to 30 dB down. And if that is the case, the performance of the helical antenna will not change much. So this had been used very successfully during early days when they wanted a simple circularly polarized helical antenna. Of course, nowadays there are a lot of other options. One can use a circularly polarized microstrip antenna as a feed also, which is relatively more compact compared to helical antenna. So now let's just see the practical implementation of this 2x2 array of helical antennas. And this design example again has been taken from the other books. So this is antenna has been designed at 800 megahertz. So just to tell you here, so one can see here that there is a 2x2 array of helical antenna, and each array element has n equal to 6, that means it is a 6-turn helical antenna. They have chosen as alpha equal to 14 degree, anyway 12 to 14 degree is acceptable. So by now using these 4 helical antenna, one can get larger gain. And now let's see how the feed network has been done. So the feed network is shown over here. So we know that the impedance of a helical antenna can be say around 140 to 150 ohm depending upon how we feed it. But that 140 to 150 ohm, then a taper section has been used to transfer this impedance to about 200 ohm. So this one again similar section, so transfers the impedance to 200 ohm, transfers the impedance to 200 ohm. Now 200 ohm in parallel, 4 of them will give rise to 50 ohm. So at the junction point, we can feed with the coaxial feed with the 50 ohm coaxial line and a 50 ohm connector, and that will work as an antenna. So we have already discussed about how to design these antennas. So corresponding to 800 megahertz, just to tell you, so what you need to do, here it is given there, what is the diameter, which is 0.3 lambda. So corresponding to 0.3 lambda, one can calculate what will be the C. C will be pi times this value. And so once we know the frequency, we can calculate what is lambda, and then we can find the dimension, okay? And once we choose alpha, then we know what will be S lambda. And once we know S lambda and we know C lambda, we will know the length of the one wire. And since we know the number of turns are 6, so the total length will be nothing but 6 times L. So that is what we need to do to design this particular antenna. So the size of the ground plane is also given over here. So now let's see what are the results we get out of this here. So we'll come to this particular here in a little while, but first let's just look at the VSWR performance. As one can see that the antenna was designed at 800 megahertz, and one can see that VSWR less than 2 is there, right from 600 megahertz to 1000 megahertz. So that's a fairly large bandwidth. You can actually think about the bandwidth is about 400 megahertz approximately. So 400 divided by 800, that is almost 50% bandwidth which has been obtained. I still feel the VSWR value could be slightly improved by designing this particular taper section more appropriately so that it will match better with the 50 ohm, but that's okay. Still VSWR is less than 2. In fact, for most of the region VSWR is actually less than 1.5, so it is fairly good matched. Let's just look at the axial ratio. So here axial ratio numeric value is shown. So axial ratio 1 corresponds to 0 dB axial ratio, and axial ratio 2 actually corresponds to 6 dB. So 6 dB is generally not acceptable. So we can say that axial ratio is less than 3 dB up to about this particular region. But you can see that in the desired frequency range of 800, we can see that the axial ratio is fairly good. Now let's just see the horizontal and vertical component. So one can actually see that right from here to here, the two components are fairly equal. Their half power beam width is almost same, and that is why what you can see here, this corresponds to a very good axial ratio. So even here you can see the variation is slightly more than this here, but still small. And that's why one can see that it is slightly increasing. But over here one can see that the half power beam width is varying considerably, and that is why axial ratio is becoming relatively poor. So now how we can calculate the directivity? One simple thing is that we can use the formula also, but these are the measure result. So from the measure result also one can calculate. So half power beam width at this point is approximately 20 degree. So you can use the formula of 32,400 divided by 20 into 20. That will give us approximately 18.5 dB directivity at 800 megahertz. And once again I want to remind, this is not the gain of the antenna. Gain of the antenna is about 0.6 times this here. Okay. So please take these things into consideration when you need to design a helical antenna. And I also want to mention people have done lot of experimental work on helical antenna, and they have actually speaking performed experiments on multiple number of turns, 5 turn to 35 turn. They have given a lot of complicated formulas also where they have done the curve fitting. But I find that the directivity expression by this is very simple. It's easy to design, and only thing is you take efficiency to be 0.6, and then we can design the proper helical antenna for the desired gain. Now there are many other applications are there of helical antenna. So besides being used as an antenna, it can be also used as a parasitic element, and it can actually have several advantages. Let's see what are these here. So here we have a one helix here, and then if you put another helix over here, by putting this over here like this arrangement, you can actually increase the gain of the original helical antenna. Or one can think other way around. Suppose if this was the original helical antenna, and by some thing it actually happened that this wire got broken in between. So even though there is a no physical connection here, it is not that the directivity loss will be considerable. It is not that the directivity will be now only given by these many terms, but actually speaking, because of this here, this acts as a parasitic element. So this one radiates from here, the beam is in this particular direction, then these things also will get excited, and net effect is that we will still get a higher gain out of this particular thing. So this is one of the application we can use helix, or you can think even if the wire breaks in between, it will still work as helical antenna. Now this is another very interesting application where, let's say, a horn antenna which is a linearly polarized. In fact, the next topic after helical antenna, we are going to talk about horn antenna, and we'll see that majority of the time horn antennas are linearly polarized, and if you want to get circularly polarized horn antenna, we have to do lot of extra work to do that. So, but now let's see here how that linearly polarized waveform can be very simply converted to CP. So let's say this is a horn antenna. So wave is being launched in this particular fashion, and here we have these helix, and by the way, there is no feed required here, there is no coaxial connector here, nothing, just you have to support this helix somehow at this one. Right now it looks like it is suspended in the air. Of course you can't do that, so some support structure has to be provided for this particular helical antenna. However, once the wave is launched, it goes through here, and then this helical antenna converts this linearly polarized antenna to circularly polarized antenna. So it's a very, very easy and convenient way, except it requires a proper support. Now this is another thing here where this is a normal helical antenna, and now another helix has been put around that in the space which is available in between. If you recall, I had mentioned about monofiller helix antenna. Monofiller will have only one wire. Here you can think about there is another wire which has been put here. So it's not really monofiller, you can say it is a bifiller now, or you can actually think other way around, that this is the driven helix and this becomes a director helix, or we can call it a parasitic helix. Now by putting this over here, one can realize little more gain, but however, I just want to mention that gain improvement is just about 1 to 2 dB. It is not very significant improvement, but still 1 to 2 dB gain may be very good. As it is, you are not increasing the aperture. All we really require is just put another wire in between. So without increasing the aperture, we can actually get a slightly better gain out of this particular helical antenna. So it's a very good effective technique to get slightly more gain, which is of the order of 1 to 2 dB. This is another configuration, which is a polyrod antenna. This is basically a dielectric antenna, and generally these are linearly polarized antenna. So by wrapping helical around this particular dielectric, and the wave is being launched here, which will go through here, and then this particular thing will become circularly polarized antenna. The another application is that, let's say this is a corner reflector. I know we are going to talk about these things later on, we have not discussed about reflectors, horn antenna and so on, but we will discuss these things later on. So here what we have, this is the dipole antenna, which we know will be a linearly polarized antenna, and then this is the corner reflector put over here. But I can just tell you, one can do many other things. It can be just a one plane reflector, then dipole antenna, or it can be a corner reflector, and many a times this corner reflector angle is changed. Some corner reflectors use 120 degree angle or 90 degree angle or 60 degree, 45 degree, 30 degree. And here then what we get is linearly polarized antenna, and again if we want to get circularly polarized antenna, it is again very, very simple. Just put a helical antenna like this over here. The only few precautions need to be taken. So whatever is the frequency of this particular antenna, these helical antennas must be designed for the same frequency range in the axial mode. However, we don't need to provide any feed point over here. So that is why the term parasitic comes here. So here then what happens? The wave goes, reflects back, and it goes through over here, and that's what will give us circularly polarized antenna. Otherwise, if we want to get circularly polarized antenna for dipole, we know it will be much more hard work one has to do. We need to put a dipole here, then we need another perpendicular dipole, and then those two dipoles have to be fed with the orthogonal polarization, that means a 0 degree and 90 degree phase difference with equal amplitude. So all those things need to be put here. This is one of the very simple and effective way to realize circularly polarized antenna with higher gain compared to the dipole antenna. This is the another arrangement where this has been made more in the form of the helix lens. So one can actually see that this position is different than these two position. Basically, if you recall, you might be familiar with the lens antenna. Let's say we have a focal length, and we actually speaking, you are familiar with, let's say, this kind of a lens antenna, right? So what happens? When the wave is coming from here, it sees a relatively lesser distance, and here the wave has to travel little bit longer distance. But however, the property of this is that if the things are coming parallelly, it will get focused over here. So that is the lens effect. So here, these helical antennas can be used in such a fashion that they can actually act as a lens antenna, and thereby the beam can be focused at a given point. Okay. So these are the different applications of the helical antenna. So we'll conclude today's lecture here. So what we have discussed today, mainly the design of the helical antenna for axial mode, and for larger gain requirement, what we can do, either we make a very large tall helical antenna, or we make arrays of these helical antenna of smaller height or smaller number of turns, so that we can get the desired directivity. Then we also looked at how to do the feed for multiple elements, and we actually can feed from the backside, and then use a tapered impedance matching network to match with 50 ohm. And we saw that the results are fairly good, stable over 30% to 50% bandwidth as far as the VSWR is concerned. But generally, axial ratio was below the desired value of 3 dB over 40% bandwidth. And even the radiation pattern was symmetrical for fairly large frequency range from 700 megahertz to close to 1000 megahertz. Then we looked at some of the applications of helical antenna, which are generally good to convert linearly polarized antenna to circularly polarized antenna. So in the next lecture, we'll talk about normal mode helical antenna, how to do the design of normal mode helical antenna. I will also tell you what are given in the textbook and how those designs have to be modified to realize practical normal mode helical antenna on finite ground plane. So thank you very much. We'll see you next time, and we'll talk more about normal mode helical antenna. Bye.